So, I would like to introduce our introductory speaker today, the DEIA committee and staff of the Soto Zen Buddhist Association, with the support of the Soto Zen Buddhist Association board, has been instrumental in envisioning and bringing to fruition the Celebrating the Voices of Women series and this event today. This is part of an ongoing effort to promote diversity, equity, inclusion, and accessibility in Buddhist and Zen practice. Joining us today, I am honored to introduce Reverend Inyu Ponce Barger, the guiding teacher from All Beings Zen Sangha and a board member of the Soto Zen Buddhist Association. Reverend Inyu will provide the introductory remarks. Again, thank you, everyone. Reverend Inyu, please take it from here.
Thank you, Zena. Welcome everyone to this event, this lovely panel that we're going to be able to participate in today. My role is to both welcome you and also to kind of segue into the actual event, which is to let you know who is leading it, and that is Tova Green. So on behalf of the board and the whole organization, I want to express my gratitude to Tova for putting together this panel for us today. For those of you who don't know her, Tova goes by she/her pronouns. She's a resident at the San Francisco Zen Center. She was ordained in 2003 and received Dharma transmission from Linda Ruth Cutts in 2015. Tova is the director of the Branching Streams Network of Dharma Centers connected to the Shunryu Suzuki Roshi lineage. That network in recent years has grown to be 75 and continues to grow as sanghas spring up across the continents. She has been a primary writer for the blogs which San Francisco Zen Center publishes on its online newsletter, Sangha News. Tova co-founded San Francisco Zen Center's Queer Dharma Group, and at San Francisco Zen Center has been engaged in diversity, inclusion, and belonging initiatives during her 24 years at that institution. She has worked with those who are approaching death, both as a hospital social worker and as a priest. And Tova is a poet and a wonderful cello player as well. She is a personal friend. And maybe you know this, maybe you don't know it, but her name Tova, it means good. And some of the other things that that name means are a virtue, positivity, moral excellence. And I can say that over the 23 years I've known her, she has embodied those qualities. So I am so pleased to have her taking the lead to share with us and embrace the voices of younger women. And so with that, I'd pass it on to Tova.
So thank you, Inryu, for that warm, lovely introduction. I'm going to say a few words about how this panel came to be and then introduce the three panelists you'll be hearing today. So when I was invited by the SCBA to offer one of these 12 presentations on hearing the voices of women in Buddhism, I noticed some of the other people who've been invited. Many of them have been my teachers, and including my group teacher, Ajahn Linda Cutts, Paula Arai, Chosen Bays, and many others. I thought that it would be, I would be, I myself wanted to hear some of the voices of women who were the next generations of teachers and leaders. And I had the idea to create this panel and reached out to several women who were at least 30 years younger than I am, and who were teachers and leaders in their own ways, in their own sanghas. And the three people who are speaking today graciously said yes. We met several times by Zoom to get to know one another better and also to talk about some of our experiences as women in our sanghas, some of the difficulties and some of the things we've appreciated. And we shared some of the readings and books and articles and podcasts of women who have inspired us, Zen women who've inspired us as we've been practicing. So those are all in the resources section that's available to you, and hope you will enjoy reading or hearing some of those voices after the presentation today. So I will introduce our panelists, starting with Zenki Kathleen Batson. Zenki is the Vice Abbess of the Chapel Hill Center in North Carolina, where she has practiced with her teacher, Josho Pat Phelan, since 2000. She first tried meditating in sixth grade after reading Shunryu Suzuki's book, Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind, and she began developing a consistent meditation practice in her early 20s. Before working full-time as a priest, which she does now, Zenki worked in home health care and was a Montessori toddler teacher. She also performed as a professional musician in a rock band for children and has painted murals and exhibited her artwork professionally. Zenki is deeply drawn to the intersection of Zen teachings and caring for the more than human. Thank you, Zenki, for joining us today. Life King has an academic background, which she combined a master's degree in Buddhism and art at the University of Colorado, and her undergraduate studies were in Japanese religion and art at the University of Richmond. She lives in Richmond, Virginia, and currently serves as president of the board of Richmond Zen, where she also leads a study group about Buddhist women ancestors. Life leads a diversified life in the arts. She works as an educator, mentor, collaborator, program director, and practicing artist. Life's collage work gives expression to her ongoing de-reconstruction of images of women through the lens of Zen practice. Most recently, she was awarded a 2022 Artist Fellowship from the Virginia Commission for the Arts. In 2021, Blythe launched Open Space Education in response to the growing need for equitable access to nature, art education, and alternative modes of learning for young people in Richmond. I was recently in Richmond and attended Blythe's Jukai ceremony. Zenki Batson was there as well, as was Zenki's teacher. And I got to see some of Blythe's artwork after the ceremony. Glad you'll have a chance to see some of it as well. And then Shijun Heather Martin is a Soto Zen practitioner and lay teacher. She received Dharma entrustment from Reverend Colin Gibson in 2022 at San Antonio Zen Center in Texas. Heather's also a registered dietitian and a candy corn science correspondent for the Today Show's food section with contributions to other platforms. Heather shares her insights on Zen, food, and health as a blogger using the handle Mom of No Rank. One of her blogs is in the resource section. You'll have a chance to read it later if you'd like to follow up. So each of our three panelists is going to now give a brief, what we call a way-seeking mind talk, a talk about their path to Zen practice. And after that, we will have three questions that the panelists will address. And following that, there'll be Q&A for all of you who are participating today. So I'd like to invite Zenki to give your way-seeking mind talk first.
Thank you, Tova. And thank you all for being here. It's a beautiful day, so I don't take for granted that you're spending your time with us here on the computer. To consolidate my path of practice into about 5 minutes, I grew up in Metro Detroit, child of a professional classical musician and a classical musician and artist. And my religious upbringing began in a massive Presbyterian church in downtown Detroit, where my father was a music director. And being invited on this panel is really interesting to me because for a large portion of my life, I didn't really see being female as having anything to do with what I was capable of or who my friends were or who my lovers were. And I see this as a privilege that was earned for me, you know, with effort and sacrifice by women before me, like my mother, and people who work really hard to gain access to situations that I've been able to enter really easily. I was the only girl on a co-ed soccer league until I was 14, and they said very kindly that I should play with other girls. In preparing for this panel, I've been really looking at what are my views about gender and my experience as a woman. And my parents had sort of a gender role reversal compared to everyone else in my working class neighborhood. My father was emotional and demonstrative, and he's the person who cared for me as a small child. And my mother was more reserved and distant and worked a 9-to-6 job. So I think that had played a role. But my mom was the first person to teach me how to meditate. And she'd also share what I later realized were Zen stories with me as a child. And after she passed, I saw a 1957 copy of Zen Flesh, Zen Bones, and realized it was a book that she kept at her nightstand. And one of my my favorite aspect of church was sitting with Mrs. Fujishiro. It wasn't actually church, but it was the time I got to spend with a woman I sort of considered to be my third grandmother. And she was just a very strong influence in my life. There's not even enough time to explain why, but I can share that when I told her, we would write letters after she became too ill to go to church. When I told her I didn't understand Christianity anymore and I was struggling with it, she just wrote back in this celebratory way with a sumi painting, "Oh, you've come to your second birthday." And I feel in general in my life, I've been really privileged to have more mental freedom than most people I know. Freedom to explore different ideas and think what I want. I spent a lot of time alone growing up and I had a lot of freedom. And music and dance and visual arts were always an important element in my life for expressing and also for figuring out what I felt about things. I started meditating regularly around 19 or so when I lived in New York City, but I really loved the natural world and moved to Northern Wisconsin. And it was there that I went to Northland College and took a course from Tom Kasulis on Taoism and Zen Buddhism. And Moon in a Dewdrop was one of our assigned reading texts, and it just changed the trajectory of my life, reading the Sansuikyo and Genjo Koan. And the philosophy program and religions program at Northland was had this Eastern focus. So there was a lot of material, even though I was in a really remote rural place. I had access to a lot of Buddhist readings. And one of those books was the book Meetings with Remarkable Women. And I remember very clearly looking at that book and thinking, oh, that woman looks like she could be my neighbor. That person looks, I saw images of people, women doing this thing that seemed far away, and it made it look possible for me. And that was really critical. I read a lot of Thich Nhat Hanh and then did a retreat with Thich Nhat Hanh and received the precepts for the first time from him. And after receiving the precepts, I started thinking about trying to find a community there in rural Wisconsin. And I would take trips to various places. I went to the Milwaukee Zen Center for an extended weekend and practiced with Tozen Akiyama, and he was a great influence. He was very kind, and he taught me Orioki. And I recall seeing him sitting in the Zendo and having the experience that that was the most, you know, he was sitting Zazen, thinking that was the absolute most beautiful human being I'd ever seen in my entire life. And if you know Akiyama Roshi, it's not the first thought you have when you meet him that he's the most beautiful person, but there is something about that posture. But I didn't want to move to Milwaukee. I moved to Minnesota eventually and sat with the Minnesota Zen meditation group. And that's where I met the person I've now been married to for 24 years. And he wanted to move to North Carolina. And at that point, I knew I wanted to ordain. So I had to see if there was a Zen center in North Carolina. And lucky for me, there was. And the day I met my teacher, Josho Pat Phelan, I felt like I knew I had met my teacher. And it had to do for me with the way she held things, the way she engaged with what she was doing in the moment. And I wanted to learn that. She said she wouldn't ordain till after she knew we wanted to have a child, and she wouldn't ordain me till after we had our child, because often that can change the trajectory of your life. So my son was born in 2004, and he was a great artistic influence. I did a lot of painting and wrote a lot of songs and did a lot of showing of art while he was a child. But when I started to prepare for ordination, there really wasn't time for that. And so I find that in my role as a teacher, I bring the creativity in to that, but I look for ways to find time to engage in visual artwork still as well, because it's still important to me. At our center, the leaders are all women, and both men and women clean the bathrooms, wash the dishes, serve as Eno Tenzo work leader, ward president. Men and women both run chainsaws, get on the roof. So I feel very fortunate to be in an environment where it doesn't feel like gender is getting in the way of the roles we're playing, that we're working together. So that's kind of a basic, quick run of things. And I believe now I'll pass it on to Heather, is that right? Are you speaking next?
I think so, yeah. Is that right? So, Thanks so much, Zinky. I really enjoyed hearing your talk, even though we've been chatting a little bit. There was a lot there that I hadn't heard before. I really enjoyed that. Thank you. So everyone, I'm recovering from an illness, and I just got my voice back yesterday. So cross your fingers with me that it holds out. I wanted to thank Tova for the idea for this panel and for the invitation. I'm so happy to be contributing today, and I really want to thank everyone for attending. So for my own path, I started practicing in 2003 as a young mother when my child was two, and it was in a time of really deep distress and pain, but really my way started a lot earlier than that. I was really close to my grandmother, who was a devout Methodist. I think it would pain her to hear me put it this way, but she sort of ruined me for other Christians. It wasn't just her that caused me problems. I think Zinky said something similar. I didn't understand the Bible until I had a meditation practice. So there were other problems, but my grandmother sort of earned her really powerful faith through the worst hardship, including losing a child. And it wasn't fair of me to compare her to some poor 30-year-old pastor with so little life experience, but growing up, I couldn't help it as a child. And I found it really confusing when their understanding of the Bible and their behavior failed to live up to hers. But another step on the way for me was at a church that I really loved with a minister who was an older man that I thought him really wise. And I was confirmed in that church. And after my confirmation, he asked me to train as an acolyte, which was a really big deal. I was the first girl there ever. And he told me that he noticed that I took the classes seriously for confirmation and that I was kind. And so he wanted to ask me to fulfill that role. And so I accepted and I did the training. A couple of days before the first service as an acolyte, he called and spoke to my father and told him that he had changed his mind and that he couldn't go through with it. He couldn't let a girl fulfill the role of acolyte. And my father argued my case, but unsuccessfully. And I was only 12 years old then. But I understood immediately that my ideas about ethical conduct differed from his, and that I was not going to give up my view. So many years later, when I read a story of Princess Yeshodawa, where she was practicing diligently, and some monks noticed this and came to tell her that they were gonna pray for her to be born a man in her next life. And she struck her staff on the ground and vowed to always be born a woman, even unto Buddhahood. I knew I was in the right place, even though some parts of other sutras are difficult. So shortly after I was disinvited to be an acolyte, my mother and I were talking about world religions. She's a librarian and knows a lot about these things. And I asked her what Buddhists believe, and she said something like, Buddhists believe that the divine is in everyone, which isn't maybe the way I would put it now. I might say something like the divine isn't separate, if I was going to use those terms. But when she said that to me, I thought, oh, that's right. And from that moment on, I knew that I would practice Buddhism. But I was afraid it would hurt my grandmother. And I waited until she passed away. So I read books, but I didn't really start to try to practice until my family, some people around me were really in a dire crisis. And I was trying to understand how to help them, how to, my motivation was to embody even more compassion for the people around me who were suffering. And at first I tried practicing alone. I figured you would just read the instructions. But I didn't get very far without a Sangha. And so I found a little tiny group in San Antonio. And my kind of secret wish or idea about practice was that it would help me not have needs so that I could just worry about everyone else more. But of course, that's not what I got. What I got was a realization that I had been drawing a really firm line between myself and others. And that line does not exist. So I learned to include myself in the universe. And so that was really hard. And I owe a great debt to the very tiny little group of people that were renting a very small space at a Shambhala Center in San Antonio. But after a couple of years, their paths led them other places. And just a handful of us total newbies were trying to hold the forms as best we could without a teacher there for several years. And we I'm so grateful to the Houston and Austin centers and all the teachers who traveled there. I met so many people at those centers. Mel Weitzman, Tia Strozer, my first Dokusan was with Flint Sparks. I'm just dozens of people that came and went over those years. And as my family crisis, resolved, and my practice deepened, I had this wish for monastic practice, but I couldn't understand a way to do that and care for my child. So I explored lay practice, with the help of many generous teachers, my teacher Colin Gibson included. But I want to confess that at the time I imagined lay practice as a sort of consolation prize for not being able to participate in real Zen. And so I want to take pains to let anyone who may be in lay practice, who might be thinking of it that way, something they have to settle for, that it's nothing of the sort. You do need a Sangha somehow. But if you're struggling with this question, just keep sitting with that and look carefully. I think my path illustrates a lot of concerns and experiences that many women have. And so I'm grateful to be included. And I'm going to hand it off to Blythe.
Well, I came to practice by way of the slow cook method and confusion. I've only been practicing Zen for 7 years, and I was already 40 by the time that I came to practice, and my lay ordination was just 3 weeks ago. And I say slow cook method, which is actually what my teacher, Edin Kevin Heffernan, calls Soto Zen, because I began my study of Buddhism when I was 20 in college at the University of Richmond. But it took me another 20 years to actually come to practice with my Sangha at Richmond Zen. And my confusion is largely being in this body of a woman in a culture that encodes specific gender stereotypes and expectations based on appearance. I got a lot of mixed messages regarding gender growing up in the 80s in a suburb north of Pittsburgh. Early on, I was struck by the fact that my sister and I didn't have middle names. We inherited the expectation that we would get married to a man, and our maiden name would become our middle name as we took our husband's last name, like my mom did, and her two sisters did, and their mom did. So I grew up in a very traditional American household where gender roles were clearly defined and enforced. But I was confused because at the same time, my sister and I were told that we can do anything that we want to do and be anything we want to be. My dad wouldn't let my mom work, even the one time when she expressed a desire to. And I was also often mistaken for a boy growing up. I'm tall. I've had short hair most of my life. I'm tomboyish and an athlete. So I'm struck by how differently people perceive gender, and even more interested in how that affects our interactions and our relationships with each other. And what implications does that have for the ways that we can imagine women more broadly? So I remember my teacher's teacher, Josho, describing way-seeking mind as when you want liberation from conditioning. And I think I felt that early on in this confusion as a young girl. And I think I was finally drawn to Zen practice for the way that it makes us aware of imposed limitations as a result of conditioning, and then offers a way to expand possibilities beyond them. So my first solo art exhibition was titled How to Take a Compliment, which is also the title of one of the collages in the show. And it's of a 1940s fashion model transformed into a Saint Sebastian or Saint Sebastien figure, a martyr shot multiple times with arrows. And I can hear my mom saying to me growing up, "Can't you take a compliment?" But I was confused, like, what if these compliments you're receiving don't match your values? What if they're just based on this conditioning that limits the ways that we view women? So these experiences growing up gave me a heightened awareness of being a woman in a patriarchal culture. It prepared me for the work that I do today as an artist, a mentor, an educator. It's very clear to me when women are being undermined, when they're left out, and I feel a responsibility. So looking back at my academic study of Buddhism, especially in graduate school at the University of Colorado, I realized how much women were left out. The field was dominated by Eurocentric men, and that's the scholarship I inherited. It really takes women in the field to uncover the full impact of women's participation in society and history. And the study of Zen back in the late 90s and early 2000s was largely Rinzai, which I see as a symptom of that male-dominated field. So many of the stories that we studied were those hyper-masculine koans known for their shocking violence. And I remember having to turn myself into a man to relate to these stories. And the only story I remember about a woman in Zen was Rionen, who had to burn her face with an iron in order to study with a male teacher. And I just learned about the Terigata, the collection of enlightenment poems by the first Buddhist women 4 years ago. And it's thought to be the oldest collection of women's voices that we have in the world, dating back 2000 years. So I'm so moved by these poems in the Terigata. I feel like they could be written today. So the theme of liberation is clear, liberation from myriad causes of suffering. that women continue to experience today, including the social conditioning that limits the ways that we view women. And this includes media images, images from advertising and comic books, like the ones that I use in my art. So over the years, my collages have evolved from transforming these media images into boundless portraits of women to reworking the images into visual diagrams of Zen meditation. So my current work shows activity within an expansive field. These fragments cut from magazine pages float and orbit around gold leaf circles. The portraits visualize thinking in the midst of our originally radiant, naturally awakened mind beyond the limitation of our conditioning.
Thank you, Heather, and thank you, Senki. I think in your stories, your talks about your paths, you have touched on some of the questions that we're planning to go into a little more deeply. So I'm just going to say what these questions are, and let's start with, I'll say what all three questions are. We have about 20 minutes to delve into these questions, so we may not examine them as thoroughly as we might want, but then we'll have time in the Q&A with participants to go deeper. So the first one is, what challenges and opportunities have you experienced as a woman in your Zen practice or studies? The second question, and I think all of you addressed that to some extent, and the second question, what women teachers or ancestors have inspired you? Which we all of you spoke to that as well. The third question, what would you like to see for future generations of women in Zen and beyond? And I would suggest we make sure we have enough time for that question. So let's start with the first question and hear Heather's response first. And let's see if we can take maybe 5 minutes for that question.
I think that's doable. I had a little bit less prepared than asked for. So challenges that women face, it did naturally come up in all of our Way Seeking Mind talks. And I think there's sort of a two-part way to explain it. And because women, it's also true of men, men are also obviously compassionate, and some of the things I say will resonate for some women and not others, and they will resonate for men as well, as that's to be expected. It's straight out of the Sandokai. And so I'm not leaving the fellas out, but women often have a natural tendency for empathy and compassion. It's not just innate, but expected and rewarded. So it's conditioned. And that means that conditions are ripe for us to frequently put others ahead of ourselves. We're more likely to take on caregiving roles for children or parents or as a profession. And so that expression of compassion, if not ubiquitous, is really common. And I think there's a reason why Avalokiteshvara is often portrayed as a woman. And men are also compassionate, of course, as my own father in the story I told is a good example. But women are more likely to prioritize the expression of it to their main roles. And the irony of that is that our gifts or tendencies are they mean that we have a lot of competing spheres of the expectation of service or the desire to offer service to others at home, at work, with extended circles of friends and extended family. And that is itself the root of some of the barriers. So there are huge time constraints. Can we participate in monastic practice? Can we even make it to the zendo on a regular basis? There is a perceived lessening of our value. Caregiving roles are not compensated very well, or not at all. And they often aren't very respected from the greater society. And the fact that we offer these roles often, it means that they come to be expected. So if you don't want to offer them, or if you, for your own reasons, don't have the capacity because of your own physical needs, you still have to wrestle with that expectation, your own expectations and that of others around you. So as we were chatting, Tova and myself and Zinke and Blythe, there were a couple of points that Zinke and Blythe actually made. And I promise you, I'm not putting them on the spot. I discussed this with them ahead of time. And I wanted to ask them to comment on them because I think that they shed some light on the barriers and what we can do about them. And so Zinke, you said something so apt in your discussion of the way compassion and caregiving might be undervalued when we were talking. Could you talk just a couple of minutes about that?
Well, I think one of the things I spoke about is that it actually takes a lot of strength to be gentle, kind, patient, and compassionate. And it's not often recognized as strength. Like you said, there's sort of this, I worked as a home health care provider, hospice care, child care worker for 25 years. And I've looked at how did I get into this? My mother was not, I love my mother, but she was not a demonstrative feminine caregiver. She was pretty absent. So that was not the role I saw mother being, right? So was I held to do this to make up for something? You know, it's really fascinating for me to consider the causes and conditions that caused me to be such a engaged in compassion work. But our culture tends to look at what you might call a masculine expression of strength as what strength actually is. Whereas there's an assumption that being available and nurturing children is just something that happens easily. And when you're in a room with 12 2-year-olds with one other adult, you can learn very quickly that it really takes skill to navigate that well. But it's not recognized as a skill, which I think is what you were articulating so kind of eloquently. And
exactly.
I think from my perspective as somebody who learned how to navigate the combative person with dementia, or the screaming, the 12 screaming children who've all been dropped off at once, is that what's called strength often in our culture, from my perspective, is kind of a lack of discipline and effort towards being aware of what's arising in oneself. You know, like irritation or aggression, being aware of it and channeling that energy in a more constructive way. often it's a more aggressive response that's considered strength. And I feel like what I learned in those roles is that anything, any boundary can be set with compassion. You can, there's a way to navigate setting clear boundaries compassionately. I learned a lot from toddlers in that regard. So, and I just think it's funny that it's a Smiths lyric from Morrissey. So if you're a child of the 80s, then you know the lyric of, it's so easy to laugh, it's so easy to hate, but it takes strength to be gentle and kind over and over and over and over. And that lyric goes through my mind a lot. So yeah, I appreciate everything you've shared.
Oh, that was excellent. Thank you so much. And Blythe.
Heather.
Yeah.
Are we out? Yeah. I think it would be good to move on to the next question and not hear from Blythe on this one, if that's okay.
Okay, that's okay. Could I Could I just sum up quickly?
I think we need to move on.
Okay, go ahead. Okay.
Yeah, so the next question is, what women teachers or ancestors have inspired you? And Blythe was going to respond first. And maybe it won't be possible for all three of you to respond, so we can get to the third question, which I think is really important.
Yeah, well, I've really just begun my study of our women ancestors, and but our first woman ancestor in India, great teacher, Maha Pajapati, really stands out to me. You know, she was Siddhartha's aunt who raised him after his mother died 7 days after giving birth. And if it weren't for her, I'm not sure what Buddhism would look like today. I really see her story as a how-to guide for women living in a patriarchy. She led the multitudes of women, prostitutes, homeless widows, along with queens, to ask the Buddha to include them in the monastic community, because at first women were not included. And they had to ask three times, be rejected three times. They had to find a male ally in Ananda before the Buddha offered access to women. And of course, this was not without special conditions. But that this story is built into the tradition, this acknowledgement of how women navigate a patriarchy and how they can imagine new possibilities together as a group, I think is significant for all women practicing today. And I did want to also, I mean, I'm also deeply inspired by my women mentors who guided my academic study of Buddhism, including my undergraduate professor, Dr. Miranda Shaw at the University of Richmond, my graduate professor, Dr. Sarah Horton, who I worked with as a teaching assistant, and then Buddhist scholar, Dr. Paula Arai, who has inspired me with the work that she's done focused on Zen and healing. And she also took me on my first walk with the redwood trees, which was equally inspiring. But like our Buddhist women ancestors, women scholars of Buddhism have persevered in their fields despite obstacles and setbacks. I know a number of women who had been denied tenure because the field just wasn't ready for them. But they persevered, and it's taken decades of work, but the field has changed. And I think we're seeing the effects of these women. Women have transformed the face of Buddhist studies. It doesn't look like it did in 2002. And they've broken through largely with the new emphasis on the body, like how Buddhism is embodied through practice. And this includes ritual, dance, monastic life, and art. And these are aspects of study that had been largely dismissed for quite some time. But these women's work has been quite revealing, and long-held theories, especially about Buddhist art, are being dispelled. So the way that these women have changed the shape in the course of Buddhist studies has also been very healing for me as a scholar and a practitioner. And I've been able to experience the shift in the field, and I have boundless gratitude for my women teachers.
Thank you, Blythe. So I think that could segue into what would you like to see for future generations of women in Zen and in the wider world? You know, the experiences that you've had, that teachers and family members and clergy that have inspired you, and teachings that have been offered by women in not only in academia, but in Zen centers, some of our role models. How does that affect what you would like to see for future generations of women? And we'll start with Zenki.
Well, in thinking about that, what I, my deepest hope really is for that in sanghas, and that all Zen practitioners act like true adults, you know, that we all take responsibility for our own behaviors and our own limited conditioned views that we invariably bring to situations, our own karmic conditioning. And I appreciate how Uchiyama Roshi somewhere defined bodhisattva as a true adult, you know, that. So I see if we truly look into each other's eyes, you know, as human beings, and see Buddha, and really meet each other and what's happening in each moment, and be willing to really bring to light situations or experiences that may need us to look at gender bias and how gender karma is playing a role. To follow Buddha's teaching would be the best way to do that from my perspective, you know, that we approach things with openness and don't know mind and willingness to hear other perspectives, you know, because I feel like we can discuss gender in an abstract way and that can have value, but that the actual movement toward equity and respect and dignity and peaceful community comes from the choices we make in each situation, you know, of our actual life, which, and where it's complex and nuanced beyond conceptual ideas, where we have to navigate what an appropriate response would be. And then, you know, as far as a wider society, I feel this concern for what feels like a backwards movement lately for women's rights, especially in terms of our own bodily autonomy. But I have this tendency to see human behavior like this pendulum, you know, of response. Things happen, then there's a swing in response. And so my approach is to try to stay rooted and look at what are the causes and conditions propelling this pushback, you know, that feels so counter to progress, and try to understand it. I feel like that is that's what we're taught to do. So that's how my heart responds to that question.
Thank you. Yeah. Blythe or Heather, would one of you like to follow with your thoughts about what you'd like to see for future generations of women, or how you are helping to make that happen for future generations of women?
Well, I'd like to just offer something very specific to our practice that I would love to see is the, I guess, like, first we started to chant the acharyas, the names of the women ancestors, as part of our full service at Richmond Zen. That's been very meaningful to me. And we actually alternate days now, chanting the men's names and the women's names. But what I would really love to see is the merging of our men and women ancestors and them chanted together.
I love that. I think what I hope for is for people to see that the barriers are themselves gates to practice. So family responsibilities may be the greatest pull away from the Zendo, but they're often also our greatest impetus to practice. Our perceived weaknesses are strengths. And the biases against us are opportunities to walk the path with others.
Is there any way in which you see yourselves as mentors for next generation of practitioners, or the next generation of young people, whether they're Buddhist or not?
You know, I could answer that briefly. I often feel like in my profession, as a writer, a registered dietitian, I'm talking to clients or the reader from a Zen perspective, even if it's not overtly so. And I try to always embody that inspiration that I've received from other people, to let it flow through me to others, to care for the body, care for the mind, and care for others, you know, whether it's yourself or another person. I hope so. That's one of my deepest intentions.
I think that's something for myself that I'm very aware of. For some reason, I see my battery is running low, so I'm going to make sure my computer's plugged in. But I wanted to say that I'm trying in my own practice at San Francisco Zen Center to step back from some leadership roles and make space for the next generation to lead. There are people ready to do that. So that's something that I feel as an elder is something I really am mindful of. And I don't think you are yet elders, but you will be someday if all goes well. And I can imagine that you are already inspiring younger generations in your centers and in your families. So I think it's time now to hear from participants what questions they have. So Zena, shall I turn it over to you to remind people of how they can ask their questions?
And yes, and thank you so much, Tova. And yes, this is the time for Q&A. And I'm just going to put a little information about your privacy and how we're going to manage this today in the chat. Also, your privacy is important to us. Please note that if you choose to unmute your microphone to ask a question, instead of using the chat feature, your voice and image will be captured in the recording. This recording will be made public on the SZBA YouTube channel, and thank you for your understanding about that. And if you would like to submit your comment or question via chat, feel free to do so. If you want your question or comment to remain private, please start your message with the word private.
This is not so much as a question. I've just got multiple comments. If I started with questions, I got to tell you, it'd be too many. I found this so uplifting. Tova, thank you for doing this. And I sincerely hope that you do something very similar again. I would love to hear more. You mentioned about future leaders, and I just heard with Heather, Blythe, and Zinke, truly like two of y'all I know, two people that and Heather, I'm sure the same with you, truly people that are future leaders. And I look forward to whatever y'all bring to our practice in the future. So again, it's not questions, but I just wanted to let you know how uplifting and how good this has made me feel. I just so enjoyed it. So thank you.
Thank you, John. And appreciations are welcome as well. Or sharing your own experience is welcome. It doesn't have to be a question.
Well, we have a question in the chat that I just wanted to acknowledge. Heather, could you say a little bit more about your insights into becoming a lay or ordained teacher rather than a priest?
I'm not sure if this is what they mean, but I didn't decide to become a lay teacher. I did decide to embody the practice given the supports that I had. Pardon my cough, my voice is probably giving out. The entrustment was offered to me, but it's not something that I decided. I don't know if that's the answer that they were looking for. But I did, you know, as I mentioned, at first I thought of it as making my peace with what I could do. And in time, I came to understand that to think lay practice is not real Zen is a misunderstanding.
And we have a question from Eden.
Thank you, everybody. I have appreciation and a question. One is, and my appreciation is, actually the younger generation can inspire and teach older generation as well. So thank you for that going in all directions. My question is, what would you all want your male peers and teachers and juniors, generally male members of the Sangha, to know about what it is and how your experience has been as practicing as women, and how it might be different or difficult in ways that men are generally oblivious to? Thank you.
I think just very quickly, socially, there's a what feels like an assumption among men in our society, and I'm really generalizing, that they're supposed to know things. Even though we're taught about don't know mind, it feels like there is often this, that I find that men often seem to be compelled to show that they know things, and to show that, and to tell me what they know. And so I think a general just sort of request, if I'm just being very honest, would be to approach things with a don't know mind, and have that don't know mind include the possibility that I may know more, that a woman may know more about a topic than you think they do. That's what comes to mind for me.
I think I would like to say, let go or be dragged. And I'm hoping Blythe might tell that story that I was going to ask her to tell.
Yeah, my short answer was that men can also make tea. So the story is basically women and my Sangha came together because we found that we were offering book study after Sunday service. And, you know, after our last vows, we would announce book study and everyone would kind of click into this default mode where the men stood around socializing while the women went to the kitchen to make tea. And this went on for months. This was just like this automatic thing. And I was like, I'm boycotting, like, but somebody obviously had a better idea to go and talk to Eden about it. And it's still imperfect. You know, Eden still has to voluntel men to make tea. That's kind of the way. And we've been doing that for like 2 to 3 years. But again, this is this example of conditioning, you know, and how, you know, that sort of default thinking can reinforce gender hierarchy, like even in the Zendo.
We have a question from Gretchen.
Yeah, thank you. And I think all three of you have talked around this a little bit, but I thought maybe we could make it more explicit. My question is, do you, and inspired in part by Blythe's remarks about Maha Pajapati, do you think it's important for women to find other women in Sangha? Because sometimes that's not available. And then the corollary question is, do you think that it's important for women to find women-only practice spaces? And whoever wants to comment on that.
I can go ahead. I think it depends on the woman, and probably the men around them. When I came to practice with a Sangha for the first time, there were actually no women in the group, and it was not an issue. I felt incredibly supported and respected. I have not felt the need really to seek out women-only spaces. However, when I attend one like this, it's not women-only actually, but it is sort of women-centered. I think there's a lot of value to that. I don't know that it's required. It probably depends on the person.
Okay, if any of the other panelists, if they had any thoughts.
Yeah, I was gonna just say for myself, I found that having a women's study group and co-leading it with another woman, Ellen Hippard, I think has been really helpful for me. I think I feel a responsibility to continue telling the stories of our women ancestors. And I think it matters that we have a variety of perspectives in looking at these stories and retelling them in a way that is meaningful to our historical context and is meaningful to our own practice. And I think that our women's study group has really made that available for us and opened that discussion. And one example that stands out to me is whenever we were studying Padachara's story, somebody pointed out, like, something that's just not emphasized in the story is, like, early on, she actually defies social convention and she defies her family because she falls in love with a servant and her family is very wealthy, and she actually falls in love with one of her family's servants. So she has to, like, hide away, and they kind of, like, run away together. But somebody pointed out, like, what strength that must have taken at that time, you know, and her agency to make that decision. So to emphasize these things in the retelling of the story, I think is really important. And I think just having a community of women can be conducive to that.
We have a question from Linda.
Hi, folks. Thank you for this get together. I'm a longtime women's rights person, so I appreciate what you're talking about. One question I've got, I have, and this may not be the right way to ask it, but I'm kind of wondering if some of the format of Zen is patriarchal, has patriarchal beginnings. Kind of reminds me sort of the military sometimes, just that sometimes rigidity is the word that I kind of want to use. And I'm just wondering if, you know, if this could have some patriarchal aspects to it. If it were women, I would imagine the format would be more open, I would think, to allow for childcare, elder care, and other things. And I just kind of wonder if this isn't kind of set up for, you know, people that don't have those kinds of obligations to have to consider in their lives.
I can share that from my understanding, the way Zen has come to us as Western practitioners is sort of a male monastic model, you know. So for those of us in the Branching Streams affiliated schools, it's the Shinryu Suzuki came, and he originally was working with the Japanese American Buddhist lay practitioners. But, and Tova actually probably could speak much more succinctly about all this, but that the interest of Westerners in sitting Zazen motivated him to begin teaching the non-Asian population and develop a sangha that he based on, you know, male monastic Zen practice, which is what he knew. And friends that I've known who've practiced with women in Japan in Nisodo settings, which are women monastic settings, they've often said to me, I wish we sat more Zazen. We've been doing a lot of, they're busy from day to night. It's still very, your day is still highly regulated, but they were expressing that they did less Zazen and had more flower arranging and making tea and other activities. So that's all I can share about it.
I'd like to jump in just briefly. When Suzuki Roshi, Mayazumi Roshi, Katagiri Roshi, those Japanese teachers who established centers in the, I guess it was in the 60s, Suzuki Roshi came in 59, but Zen Center wasn't established till 1962. They were men, but some of their students were women. They ordained some women. And then what I am aware of is that the next generation of teachers, like Sojin Weitzman and Tenshin Rev Anderson, have ordained many women. That's true in the Mayazumi Roshi lineage too. Many women who are well-known teachers now and have written books. And you know, I think that as more many of these women are leading their own Zen centers. So that's a big change that's happened. I think that Zen still has its patriarchal roots, and yet there's much more awareness of gender issues now, and more awareness of the patriarchal heritage that we're working with. And I think that's one reason this Soto Zen DEI, the SCBA DEIA committee had the vision to have this year of hearing the voices of women in Zen. There are more women in Zen writing books. You know, I love the idea of integrating the acharyas and with the Dayo shows. I don't know what it would take to do that, but you know, even to receive a Kechimiyaku with the women ancestors, when you receive Jukai or ordination, we're still working with that to do that uniformly at San Francisco Zen Center, although many of the branching stream centers do that. So I think this is a work in progress. And the more women, like the three of you who are in your sanghas and practicing with the people in your communities and families, then there will be more of a shift, for the generations that follow. But we have our work to do, you know. It's a work in progress, what I'd say.
Well, if it's okay, I would like to move on to the next question. The next question is, since women are conditioned to be compassionate, are there other parts of the practice that may not be emphasized to men that we should focus more on? And if you need me to repeat that question, that's fine.
I think we often forget that that compassion and wisdom are paired in Buddhism together as a teaching, you know, especially when I was introduced to Buddhism in an academic setting, the compassionate element wasn't really brought to light. And it's not explicit in a lot of writing. I think I feel like partly because culturally it's a given that you're supposed to behave compassionately towards others in a way that's not as explicit in our very individualistic culture. So remembering that wisdom and compassion always go together is what arises in my mind, is what we should remember.
Are there any other thoughts from the panelists?
I liked that answer a lot.
Yeah, I was just looking at the schedule for today, and it seems like we may be at the time for closing remarks.
Okay. You and I were on the same wavelength. And I just wanted just to check if there were any, just like any brief comments or questions or anything as we move on to close. And to check in with Andrew to see if they had any closing remarks or anything like that. And if not, I'm sorry, Tova. You raised your hand.
I would like to offer a few thank yous. Okay. Just my closing remarks, if that's okay. Yeah. First, I want to thank Blythe, Zenki, and Shijun Heather for your wisdom and compassion and articulate expression of your practice and experience. I want to thank you, Zena, for the support you gave us along the way, and the way you're supporting our offering today. and also Keegan behind the scenes. And I want to thank this BSCBA DEIA committee for having the vision to do this series. So great. And thank you everyone who's here today participating. And I imagine some people will watch this later. So I just appreciate everyone who's interested in the topic and made the time to be with us today. Thank you.